Revelation chapter 10. And I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head. And his face was as it were the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire. And he had in his hand a little book, and it was open. And he set his right foot upon the sea, and his left foot on the earth. This is obviously a magnificent angel. There are some very good Bible teachers that believe that this is the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't really know if I agree with that, but that's a moot point. It's a magnificent angel. Not that Jesus is an angel, Jesus is God. But sometimes in the Old Testament, when it says the angel of the Lord, the most magnificent and mighty, because an angel is a messenger, and the Lord is our mediator between our Heavenly Father Yahweh and man. But in this case, I believe it's just a great and magnificent angel, but I could be wrong. Other Bible teachers believe this is Jesus Christ, because he has the power to do as he wills with the earth, to calm the storm, to create calamity, to bring famine, to bring abundance. He can do all these things. But the point being is there's a magnificent angel, and John is witnessing it. And I think that's really where we need to focus our attention. And he cried out with a loud voice, as when a lion roareth. And when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write. That's John speaking. So John was about to write what the seven thunders had spoken, at least that he could understand. Then John heard a voice from heaven saying unto him, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. There are sometimes mysteries that Christians need to keep to themselves. Personal testimony, pearls that are theirs, they're for them. And when you cast your pearls before the swine, they turn on you, they use it against you. So be careful what you just throw out to the multitudes. Not everything is for the multitudes. That's why Jesus brought the disciples in and shared them the mysteries of many of his parables and gave it to them, not to the multitudes, because to demonstrate your desire to serve the everlasting God, it takes a desire. And my children in my home, every day of their lives, heard the word of God. I presented it to them. We read it together. We talked about it. They had love, hugs, encouragement. But at some point in time, they have to choose to come into the fold of Jesus Christ the Lord and be his disciples because they want to, not because dad said, or mom said, or grandma said, or grandpa said, because they want to. What the seven thunders uttered here was very special. It was for those in heaven. It was for the Apostle John. Nobody else. What they uttered, we do not know. So we're not even going to try to conjecture what they said because we don't know. So let's move on. Verse 5. And the angel, this magnificent angel, which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth, lifted up his hand to the heaven. Okay? And he sware by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be time no longer. And that's why I don't really believe this is Jesus Christ. This is just an angel, because Jesus Christ is the Creator God. He did create the heavens and the earth. He created everything. our Heavenly Father Yahweh bestowed that upon him so that he would do this. And that's why he is our mediator, because he knows it all. And when he came to this earth to offer himself up, mankind had no idea who was walking amongst them. They really didn't. Even his disciples, they really, even after his crucifixion and resurrection, they really still didn't really know what he was, because he is so magnificent. And us, as we look backwards, we say, oh man, how did you not see this? Well, because they were right in the middle of the forest and they couldn't see the whole forest because they were surrounded by trees. If you've ever had that effect, sometimes you got to look back and you say, in your own life, you say, oh, I don't know why I didn't see that. Because we have to learn. We have to struggle to grasp mysteries. God wants it that way, so we're not all just spoon-fed, served on a silver tray, you know. So this angel, swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there should be time no all longer. When this angel's cranking it out, the time for man, as they would like it to be, is about over. And very shortly, time on the earth, as God would have it to be, is about to begin. Almost. There's going to be some more judgment, some more, you know, bestowing of wrath upon the earth, but it's just about that time. Verse 7. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. And the voice which I heard from heaven spake unto me again and said, go, take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel, which standeth upon the sea and upon the earth. And I went unto the angel and said unto him, give me the little book. And he said unto me, take it, and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey. Ezekiel had this very same experience. He ate the scroll that was handed to him. Very similar experience. Sometimes when prophetic insight is given to you, it's sweet because it's God speaking to you. But sometimes the message is very harsh and brutal because the time has come for a judgment, for wrath, for discipline, for correction. And it's sometimes hard to swallow, even though it tasted sweet. I believe John has this experience here. And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up. And it was in my mouth sweet as honey, and as soon as I had eaten it, it made my belly bitter. He said unto me, thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings. That's very interesting that it is said that way. Would it be interesting for us as we're looking down from heaven, those of us that are with the Lord, in the heavens, as the bride of Christ, as the former church, the multitudes in the heavens, as we look down upon the earth and we see, wouldn't it be interesting if this is John the Apostle as being one of the witnesses upon the earth? Speculation. I'm a science fiction fan. I love science fiction. I just do, you know, looking back into the past and the mysteries and, you know, was there a creation of some sort before Adam and Eve and the universe? And was there that? You know, I love that stuff, you know. I love that. And here's one. And Jesus kind of said, implicated to John, to the other disciples when they were debating about who's, you know, what about me and what about them. Jesus said, if I wish him to remain until I come back, what is that to you? It's just food for thought. I don't know. You don't know. Nobody, we don't really know. But it's interesting that one of the last residents of John, I believe it's in the Ephesus area, if I'm not mistaken, in the Asia Minor, quote, Turkey, now, which was kind of the epicenter of the church in that, you know, roundabout in there, 70, 80, 90, 100 AD, something like that. Wouldn't that be interesting as he was one of the Methuselah-like people on the earth that continues to live on, and he's out there somewhere still living. Wouldn't that be really interesting and cool? I don't really know. I'm just, you know, maybe I just enjoy science fiction too much, but the reality is nobody really knows where John died. You know, we have some of the tombs of some of the apostles and so forth, but we really don't know where John died. People suspect or say, but we really don't know. It'd be very interesting if he really is still living on until, as Jesus said to the other apostles, if he remains until I come, what is that to you? Kind of an interesting statement that the Lord said. And be very, even more interesting, if it was a reality and not just a parabolic example of mind your own business, keep your pie hole closed and do your job, don't worry about John. Kind of is what he was telling to the other apostles. Do your job. Don't worry about what everybody else is doing. Do your job as unto the Lord, regardless of what it costs you. Do your job. Don't worry about anybody else, but your own testimony, your own relationship with Jesus Christ. Keep your lamp trimmed and burning. And don't worry about what everybody else is doing. Worry about your lamp and make sure that it's trimmed and burning bright and clear. We move on. Chapter 11 is knocking on the door, and so we're going to open it. We're going to go right in. Chapter 11 of Revelation. And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, rise and measure the temple of God and the altar, and them that worship therein. But the court which is without the temple leave out and measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. Very interesting. The temple, if John is transported into the future here, obviously he is, the temple is built there. Temple right now, it's not built, okay? Go to Jerusalem, the temple's not built. You know, the Islamabubs have a lot of their junk on the Temple Mount, the, you know, the big little pointy thing with a dome on it and all that. You know, but the temple of Almighty Yahweh is not there right now in the year 2016. But as John is transported into the future, the temple is there to some extent, and that the Gentiles are trampling it underfoot for 42 months. Kind of interesting. As I said before, Zechariah seems to indicate Israel will once again be dispersed abroad. They will be dragged off to Egypt and Assyria, and that in thirds, it does appear only a third of them survive. Some are caught away by great wings of an eagle when the beast reveals himself to a hiding spot of some sort. Are those helicopter? Are those eagle-like flying creatures, you know? Or is it parabolic of the swiftness at which they escape? I don't know. But there, those in Judah that see this thing are told to flee to the mountains during the tribulation period. And so John here in the future sees the temple built to whatever extent, we don't know, and it's there. So the temple will be built. at some point in time, towards the end of the age. We move on, verse 3. And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. Sackcloth, that's the burlap kind of sack, potato sack. That's not very nice. But it's a symbol of contrition, symbol of repentance, a symbol of we don't deserve the favor God has given us, but we're calling upon your mercy, O Lord. We're portraying your goodness and grace in our message to the people around us, and if only they would listen. That's kind of the why the sacks thing. It's like taking your clothes, and if you've ever worked in a place where there's a lot of fiberglass, I have done that. Worked in a factory with a lot of fiberglass around, and if you work around fiberglass a lot, your clothes, they always have scratchy stuff in it. You can never get it out. You no matter how many times you wash it, you can't get that fiberglass out. And it's always like a burlap sack. You wear it, and after a while, it's like working in a foundry, and I've worked in foundries too. You just get used to all that sand and grit on everything, on your hands and your pockets, you get used to it. And kind of for these guys here, these two witnesses, they endure it for spiritual consecration, for contrition, for repentance. And as I said, it'd be very interesting to see if John the Apostle is one of these two gentlemen. But we'll see it from a heavenly perspective, looking down. But we don't really know. Some believe Elijah. Elijah's a good one. He was caught up in the chariots. Enoch, he was caught up. Some people, Moses, because they fought over his body. Don't really know. But whoever it is, it's God's choice, right? So why debate who it is? We don't know who it is, so let's move on. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. And if any man will hurt them, fire proceeds out of their mouth and devours their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. These have power to shut the heavens that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and they have power over the waters to turn them to blood and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. They got the power. We don't have the power. The United States doesn't have the power. China don't have the power. Russia don't have the power. EU don't have the power. But to put these plagues upon the earth is in God's power. And he has given a lot of powers to these two witnesses upon the earth, and you can imagine how much hatred the rest of the earth has to these two guys that tells them they need to repent of their sin. I know when I've been out on the streets sharing the word of Christ, and you tell people they need to repent of their sin, they become enraged. They want to pull guns and knives and threaten you with them. As you tell them they need to repent of their sins, which they do. We all do. If there's sin there, you need to repent of it. It's a truth. But you know what? People don't want to hear truth. People want to hear, well, you were born this way and you were raised this way and you didn't get to go to counseling and your father was negligent and blah, blah, blah. No, your sin is your sin. And we are told to repent of our sin. Not other people's sin, our sin. And these two witnesses are laying down the law of God to the world, and the world hates them. And when the world tries to hurt them, fire comes out of their mouth to destroy their attackers. Kind of a cool thing. Verse 7. And when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them and shall overcome them and kill them. And why is Satan's little tool here, Satan's little ally, the beast, why is he allowed to kill God's men? You know why? Because their job was done. And you know what? There ain't no amount of you out there that are wicked or hate me that couldn't kill me. You know why? because my job's not done yet. When my job's done, there ain't nothing going to keep me on this earth. And you know what? I don't want to be on this earth when my job is done. I want to be up in the heavens with my Lord Jesus and all my brothers and sisters and family that have gone before me. I want to see them one day. But not yet. Not yet. Right now, I have a job to do. Continue raising a family. Be a good husband. Be a good Bible teacher, a worker, example, minister, whatever I am, to whoever I can be, to be God's little candle burning of where I go and where I am. But when God's done with me and my job's done, I don't want to be here anyway, as the witnesses. When their job was done, the beast was allowed to kill them. Not before, but when their job was done, then they were allowed to be killed. Verse 8, their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. That's a shame, isn't it? That Jerusalem, the once magnificent and glorious city where the Ark of the Covenant was, and was a witness of our Lord Jesus. Before Lord Jesus even came, where God chose to be with his people. Now it's called Sodom, the Pride Fest. Sodom, that's Pride Fest. That's the whole homo thing. There's nothing prideful about that. That's an abomination to any land. To tolerate it is to bring God's wrath. If you read Romans chapter 1, you'll see not only are the Sodomites and the Pride Festers, but those that tolerate that and give approval to that, they will invoke the same wrath of God upon their land. In Israel, and also unfortunately in this country, Sodom and Egypt. Egypt being the idolaters, they worshipped everything, frogs, alligators, bugs, the water, the sun. Idolatry. Pagan idolatry. And that once again is where Jerusalem has succumbed to spiritually once again by this point in time. Where also their Lord was crucified, our Lord. Verse 9. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in the graves. And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry, and shall send gifts to one another, because these two prophets tormented them that dwell on the earth. So it's like they're going to have a little Christmas, Santa Claus, Rudolph the reindeer, snowman festival. Be interesting if all these things start to go down right around Christmas time, where people are all wrapped up into buying presents and Santa Clauses and reindeers and not really focusing on why we're celebrating Christmas. It's a Christ Mass. The service of Christ entering this world as a man, emptying himself of his glory and majesty in the heavens to come to this earth to die. That's why we celebrate Christmas, not for Santa Claus and reindeers and snowmans and lit up trees. I like all that stuff's cool. I participate and it's fun, but it's not. That's not the point. That's just a small picture of what Christmas really is. And the manger scenes and all that, those are just pictures. Jesus is not in a manger anymore. And Mary don't have a halo on her head. She was a good woman, but she was just a person like you and I. And then God used her, like God uses me and God uses you that are followers of Jesus Christ. But we're all sinners. We have a sin nature, and we have to steer away from it continually. That's repentance. Be interesting if this kind of starts to go down around Christmas time, because that's why people give presents. That's the big time of the year where everybody kind of lays down the their, you know, their alienations, and they're generous. There's like a spirit of joy upon the earth. There really is. Be very interesting if this starts happening right around Christmas time. That'd be really when people are not expecting it, right? That'd be very interesting. Anyway, let's move on. Verse 11 of Revelation 11. And after 3 days and a half, the Spirit from the living God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. I can imagine great fear fell upon them after 3 days. Rigor mortis already set in, very possibly the bloating, and it's hard to say. But they're very shocked to see them rise upon their feet because they're God's men. And it's time to go up. And once again, the Lord's going to say, come up. You know, a lot of times, you know, the Christian church, God says, come up here. And there are those that are backslidden, you know, left behind, but they're come up. And once again, here we got come up. Elijah, he came up. Enoch, he came up. And now we have the two witnesses. They come up. And they heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them. No doubt their enemies around the world could still see them on the cable and satellite television of some sort, or on their cell phones, or internet, whatever. If electricity is still, you know, happening after all these judgments. Verse 13, in the same hour was there a great earthquake, and the tenth part of the city fell, and in the earthquake were slain of men 7,000, and the remnant were affrighted and gave glory to the God of heaven. The second woe was past, and behold, the third woe was coming quickly. So, for whatever reason, this great earthquake and this judgment here brings a lot of men on the earth to give God the glory and to stop the sin, to have a contrite and repentant heart, at least temporarily, maybe, or perhaps for the duration. But this shook them up. This really shook them up. Don't let something really big like this have to happen in your life to shake you up from whatever's going on in your life that God's not happy with, you're probably not happy with, and you just can't free yourself. Don't let a big thing happen. Just give it up. Just let it go. Let it go. Verse 15. And the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Jesus Christ is going to rule and reign forever and ever. Those of us that are the bride of Christ, his people, the children of God, the 144,000, the rebirth of the children of Israel throughout the tribulation and the millennial reign, those that have been killed in the tribulation people in the period that had turned to Jesus Christ in repentance, we are going to watch all this happen. And this earth and this heavens, to whatever extent, is going to pass away. It's going to go someplace. We don't really know where. And there's going to be a new heavens and a new earth, like a rebirthing. The earth and the heavens are all going to be, they're going to be reborn too, as those of us that love Jesus Christ were one day, many years ago. Perhaps for you, it's very shortly you're going to do that because of the word of the Lord speaking to your heart. Maybe of you, some are about to do that, but you need time in your life. Don't wait for some time in your life. Just do it right now. Just let the Lord Jesus come in. Be willing to repent, confess your sins, and invite Jesus in. And give everything you got to his service, his ministry, in whatever you're doing. If you're a businessman, if you're a military man, if you're a policeman, if you're a bodybuilder, a swimmer, a teacher, a mom, a dad, a farmer, whatever you are. Keep doing your job, but as you do your job, do it as unto the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we're here. Such the Father seeks to be his worshipers. That's why we're here, to be our Heavenly Father Yahweh's worshipers. We give glory to Jesus Christ. We're giving glory to our Heavenly Father. It's just a beautiful love circle. And the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fell upon their faces and worshiped God, saying, We give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and wast, and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast begun to reign. Kind of interesting. The seventh angel sounded, and as he sounded, things began to happen in the heavens. First, there's a declaration. The 24 elders are worshiping God. There's a great praise fest happening in the heavens. Now there's a little declaration, saying, We give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and wast, and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast reigned. And the nations were angry, and thy wrath is come in the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants and the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. It's God's job if he wants to destroy the earth, not man's job. Their ideologies of population control and, you know, and it goes on. You know, it goes on. They don't want the population to keep increasing, so there's starvation. There's population control measures enacted on this earth. They got it going. We get wars, famines, false Ebola plagues. AIDS, you know, and then they have, you can't release people's information out, so you got people dealing, serving food over the counter that have infectious diseases, and they spread it around because they're not allowed by law to tell them that they have infectious diseases, because it's the law. You can't tell them that they're infected. There is population control measures on the earth. The nuclear reactors, the poisons, and the garbage we pour out our smokestacks and our factories that destroy the earth's ozone and so forth. Man is corrupting the earth. But that's not man's responsibility to destroy the earth. If God wants to burn the earth, that's his right, because he's God, not man. So whether there will be a limited nuclear holocaust, we don't really know. Maybe there will be, maybe there won't. The Bible could or could not indicate it. We're not really sure. But by this point in time, there's things on here that are destroying the earth. And God's going to judge mankind. And very possibly the destruction of the earth is its spiritual condition to be sure, its moral condition to be sure, and also its physical well-being to be sure. Verse 19, and the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testimony, and there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail. So that's kind of the culmination of this seventh judgment, is lightnings, great voices, thunderings, earthquake, and great hail. Big judgments, hail, like in Egypt. Earthquakes, where the earth is opening up and buildings and people and cities are being sucked into the earth. That's a great judgment. But it's not the last. It's only the seventh. Seventh trumpet. Pretty soon here, we're going to get to the next round of judgments. And we will talk about them as we get to them. But there is one thing I want to back up to here, is the temple of the Ark of His Testament. In His temple, we see in verse 19, is the Ark. The Ark was like God's glow stick of the proof of His presence in the midst and among the children of Israel. And throughout David's time, we had it. Saul's time, we had it. When Samuel's time was, we had it. We roll on back to the time of the judges. It was there. And a lot of times throughout the judges, you look at the story of Samson. At some place, the Ark of the Covenant was there. But they weren't really utilizing it. They didn't talk about it. It was like it didn't exist. Now, once the time of the kings came, there was some talk about it for a while. Saul was king. David was king. Solomon was king. And a little bit into Rehoboam's reign in Jerusalem. But after that, there's kind of a vacuum, a vanishing effect of where in the world is the Ark of the Covenant? Now we hear a little bit later on, around about the time of Josiah and so forth, they found a temple in the old walls of the temple when they were renovating. They found a scroll of the law. And they took it and they put it in a box, because that's what the ark really is. It means box. And they put it in a box. And they carried it around like it was the Ark of the Covenant. But it wasn't really the Ark of the Covenant, you know, with the angels' wings upon it and they had gold on it. They just had a box and they called it the Ark. And then that was put in a secret spot that we don't really know where it is. But the Ark of the Covenant kind of really fell off the map after the Solomon Rehoboam time. There was a movie made that, you know, they found the Ark in Egypt and so forth. But really, where did it really go? Well, by this time, we see it in the heavens, right up in the temple of Almighty God Yahweh. We see the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of His Testimony was in His temple. So, whatever stories you want to believe, by the time Rehoboam hits the throne, maybe even during the time of Solomon, the Ark of the Covenant, by the time we get to the end of the kings, disappears off the face of the earth. And now look here in this book of Revelation, right around 90, 100 AD, John's transported kind of into the future, and he can see in the temple of God, in the third dimension, in the third heaven, the Ark of the Covenant in God's temple. Maybe it's there right now in history as I'm speaking, 2016. Maybe it's there now. Now let's roll the timetable back. Was it in the temple when Jesus was crucified. You know, when he was crucified and he said, "Father, into thy hands I commend thy spirit," and the veil of the temple was torn in two, was the Ark of the Covenant there? Or was just the box that Josiah hid and they found it and they put it in the temple that had the thing of the law? We don't really know. I don't really think it was the Ark of the Covenant in there. Very possibly it was the box that Josiah had. They put a scroll, a copy of the law in, and they put it in the temple. Not really sure. Because the temple was destroyed after Josiah. You know, eventually we have Zedekiah came and all the little kings in between that were all, they were all naughty. And the temple, you know, it was hanging in there. They kept stripping the gold off and paying off kings with it. But at some point in time, the Ark of the Covenant disappeared. Now, my opinion that, yes, it probably the Ark of the Covenant disappeared very possibly during the time of Solomon, Rehoboam, in there somewhere. Because it kind of vanishes out of the scriptures. Scriptures don't really talk about it really at all. And then we get to Josiah, and he talks about finding a scroll, and they put it in a box, and they call it an ark. So was the Ark of the Covenant behind the veil of the temple when it was torn in two? I don't know. I'm going to say I don't think so. But that's just my opinion, and I could be wrong. Only God really knows, or the people that were back then, if it was really documented. But even then, it's kind of hard. Historical documents are very hard to gather together, factual, truthful, you know. Like you're trying to find archaeologists that say there's no real evidence of Israel being in Egypt for that 430 years. Because they didn't build, you know, structures for themselves. Of course they didn't. They were busy spending their time building structures for the Egyptians. And they didn't get to chisel their names in the side of the pyramids or whatever they were building. The Pharaoh's name was put on the side of the pyramids, not the probably the Israelites who are building huge structures for the Egyptians. So, but we know, the Bible says, Israel was there for that 430 years, building and laboring for the Egyptians. I guess the point I want to make here is God has everything under control. And in the end, God's not going to allow his Ark of the Covenant to just fall into the hands of men, where he has put his glory. And he told them, you're not allowed to look inside. You're not even allowed to look at it. And they had veils over it and so forth. Because in the end, this beautiful thing, which is some of the very few things that God is an earth-made relic, I believe God's going to keep to himself in the heavens, and that's the Ark of the Covenant. The flip side of this is that there are very good men and women that believe the Ark of the Covenant is Jesus. And that's a good matter of fact, but I would disagree with that because Jesus is active and moving throughout the book of Revelation. He's not behind a veil or anything in the temple of God. He's moving in and out. So I wouldn't say that I totally would dispel that, but I just don't agree with that. But I believe the Ark of the Covenant at this point in history, as John is looking into the future, the Ark of the Covenant is in the temple of God in the heavens. And so my conjecture, good men before me's conjecture, is all pretty irrelevant because at this time in history, and when we go into the heavens, I believe we're going to see the Ark of the Covenant in God's holy temple in the heavens. It's just going to be one more of those really cool and wonderful things that we will be able to see and experience once we go to be with our Heavenly Father Yahweh by the precious blood that Jesus Christ, our Lord, shed for us, that we could be with God forever. My prayer to you is that you would join us. And if you are part of the us, God bless you. And I can't wait to meet you if not on this earth, in the heavens, for that big bear hug in the sky one day. God bless you, friends. See you next time.